Hello and welcome to the second forefront webinar from Dementia Researcher and the Alzheimer's Society. I'm Adam Smith, I'm the Programme Director at University College London, and today I have the pleasure of chairing this session. In our talks, we usually have two speakers, one who'll talk about their research and one who'll talk about their careers, but for the purposes of catch-up, we've broken this down into two separate recordings. So this was originally live-streamed on the 24th of September, and now we've going to hear from the second of those speakers in this video. Our next speaker is Dr. Lovesha Sivanantharajah from Bangor University, who will present a careers talk on research and parenthood and how to balance your research career whilst also being a parent. Lovesha shares her thoughts and experiences on a whole range of topics and really candidly will speak about from how you deal with initially choosing when to perhaps start a family through to through pregnancy and then through parenting in the early stages and as your family grows. So thank you very much to Lovesha for agreeing to talk with us today. Over to you, Lovesha.
Perfect. So I was asked to talk about finding some sort of balance between being a researcher and a parent. And I know this is something that's quite difficult with parents in any career path, but I think there are aspects of academia that make this especially challenging, and this is true especially for women, I believe. So I'll just talk about my experiences today and try to share anything that I've learned. Hopefully some of this or any of it will be relevant to or helpful to you guys. But I'll start off with just introducing myself. I am currently a junior research fellow that is supported by the Alzheimer's Society, and I'm based in Bangor University. And what I study is trying to understand why certain parts of the brain are vulnerable to Alzheimer's disease. So if you think about the brain as a whole, the brain is made up of different brain regions that are each made up of different types of nerve cells. And these nerve cells may be selectively vulnerable to pathogenic proteins such as tau, which is a protein that forms these tangles that you often hear about that show up in Alzheimer's pathology. And because I am a biomedical researcher, I spend a lot of time in the lab, and I use the fly as my model for studying this question. And I spend a lot of my time dissecting brains out of flies and then looking specifically at nerve cells within the fly brain to try to identify cells that are either vulnerable to proteins like tau or those that seem to be resistant. And ultimately, what I'm trying to understand is cause of disease. So that's what I do for work. When I'm not doing research, I am at home and I am a mother to a 2.5-year-old little boy named Barlow. And as it stands right now, I would say that my current status is that I'm still trying to find balance. Even though my son is 2.5 years old, I mean, all of this is still very, very new to me. And there's always a new challenge that arises, which you'll find if you have children yourself. So I'm still trying to find ways of reconciling this with the fact that I'm still in an early stage of my career. So there are the issues of, you know, uncertainty. There's also the issues with short contracts. This isn't too much of an issue for me because I am very fortunate in the sense that my partner, who is also an academic, already has a permanent position. So that helps take a bit of the pressure off of me. But I'm still trying to find this balance between parenting, work, family, having some semblance of a social life. And all of this has really been exacerbated by the pandemic, which is something I'll talk a little bit more about a bit later. But over the course of this presentation, what I'll try to do is I'll just share what I've learned so far and some tips that I've gathered from others. And the way in which I have structured this presentation is to do it in the form of questions. So earlier on, when I was asked to do this, by Claire, who works with Alzheimer's Society. She had sent me a number of questions. So I've just organized this in such a way where each slide is a question and my answer to it. And hopefully over the course of all these slides, I'll have answered most common questions that people would have. For me about this particular topic, if not, I'd be happy to take your questions at the end of this, or you could always email me privately if you have questions later on. I'll be happy to help. Okay, so the first question was, what do you wish you had known before you became a parent? And I think a lot of what I wish I had known sort of converges upon this ability to better manage my expectations. So I think the first thing would be very much that I wish I'd had a more realistic expectation about the whole process from pregnancy onwards to the early days of returning to work and even the years following, right? So I took about 9 months off for maternity leave, and then I returned to work full time. And my son's about 2.5 years now. So I've technically been back at work for a little while. However, the problem in my situation happened to be that I returned to work shortly before the pandemic, right? Which is not the ideal scenario for anyone. But what I do wish I had known, as someone told me, was to expect the best, but prepare for the worst. There are a lot of realities of the whole process, and that will vary very much from person to person, right? So, I mean, you can read the literature out there, but your experiences might not be anything like what you've read, or it might not be anything like the experiences of most of your friends or family or mentors. And I found that the whole process of becoming a parent was quite difficult, challenging, I'd say, from the very beginning. So for example, I think the easiest thing I did in the whole process was the process of conception. And I think everything else from there was a bit of a downhill slope. So there are issues with, morning sickness, or for example, like I didn't really have morning sickness so much as just a low grade illness that I had throughout beginning stages of my pregnancy. And then when that dissipated, there was, just chronic pain from being pregnant and carrying around this extra weight and the impact that has on you, right? And your ability to work. Because I just remember thinking in my head, I'm going to do so many things before I go on maternity leave. And a lot of that was impacted by, not feeling well. And there are some days, most days, where I could only really use my brain for 2 good hours. And the rest of the time, I'd feel a bit too unwell to do any intense thinking. I could do technical stuff, like go into the lab and do experiments. But if it came to like writing or thinking, that was very difficult for me. And also after you have your child, I mean, there are the fact that you have to factor in, all the sleep deprivation from the time where your child is born until you can expect them to reasonably sleep well through the night, which does take quite a bit of time. So there's that, and I think for me personally, I prefer to know what I'm up against. So I think that might be good advice if you're a similar sort of temperament. I think now, especially, there's a big element of being realistic about my goals and what I could realistically achieve. So I try to set goals for myself, but sometimes I can't make them because everything just takes a lot longer, or things happen like spontaneously. You'll end up, having to deal with a crisis. Like for example, earlier this afternoon, actually, we had to have, my husband and I had to have a teams meeting with the nursery to talk about my son's current behavior, which is not ideal. He's going through a stage where he throws a lot of tantrums. And so it's very disruptive and, you know, we have to deal with that. So there's things like that that just kind of crop up. So, you know, you just sort of have to expect that things will not go perfectly. But one thing I really wish I had known was that a useful thing could be for women returning to work is to start off by working part-time. I personally think that would have benefited me because I sort of just threw myself back in again because I was sort of relieved to be back at work and not providing full-time care for a child anymore. And I didn't factor in the fact that there was just so many things that made it difficult for me to actually be working full-time in the beginning. And a lot of it has to do with not factoring how much your brain will change during the whole process of getting pregnant and onwards, right? And I actually came across a really interesting article, and I would suggest taking a look at it if you're interested in looking at the research behind what happens to you. But it was a paper that was published in Nature Neuroscience in 2016, and it's entitled "Pregnancy Leads to Long-Lasting Changes in Human Brain Structure." And there are a lot of facts in this paper that just blew my mind, right? And some of the things that I hadn't prepared myself for. And you know, these things happen, but it's nicer to sort of have an idea of what's coming. But I mean, some of the facts in this paper just blew me away. For example, the fact that, you know, this pregnancy leads to these unparalleled surges of hormones in women, right? So you see a 10 to 15 fold increase in progesterone relative to, you know, the stage of your cycle where, you know, just after ovulation. And the fact that there are more estrogens being pumped through your body than a woman is exposed to an entire non-pregnant lifetime. And what these hormones do to your body is they have an effect on your brain cells, right? And they can change the shape and also the number of the brain cells that you have. And in this particular study, what they saw was a decrease in the volume of gray matter within these women's brains. And this is the region of your brain that contains like brain cells, right? The cell bodies of your brain cells. And the fact that it was shrinking suggests that there might be significant loss of your cells. And another interesting point is that when they looked at these women 2 years post-pregnancy, a lot of these brain changes were still there, right? And I know there's terms that people throw around like baby brain, which is something that, you know, I didn't realize how important and how impactful that could be and on you and your ability to think. But I mean, after reading the study especially, I mean, it really did put that into perspective, right? It's something that we can expect to experience because if you think about it, your brain has just gone through this massive a process where it's been structurally changed and potentially even rewired in a lot of ways. So I think it's a reminder of why we need to be kinder to ourselves and perhaps not put so many expectations upon ourselves and or even be disappointed when we fail to meet, you know, some of these expectations that we have placed or these important milestones that are expected of us as women and researchers returning back after just having a child. And I think, right, so the next question I was asked was, how do you cope with financial concerns about fixed term contracts and potentially needing to uproot your family to go to a new job? So I personally think that there is never a perfect time or place to have children, but I do think that sometimes there are better times and better places for you to have a child. So for example, it could be beneficial to you. And I've heard other women academics say this as well, that, you know, ideal times to have a pregnancy would be during periods where you have a contract of employment, right? So you know that you're going to be paid during the time where you're the time during your maternity leave, and you're not stressed out about the financial element of having a child. Right. And I think that also goes for where you have a child. I mean, so I'm Canadian, if you've been wondering about my accent. I'm Canadian. So I did my PhD in Canada. And then I did a very short postdoc in the US in the state of Missouri. And then I ended up moving to Bangor because my husband and ended up getting a permanent job at the university. So I've just been following him. And that's how I ended up here. But I do think that I right now feel very fortunate that I was able to have my child, I mean, during a time when I was financially stable, because I was in a contract and you know, and didn't have to worry about that, but also because I'm in the UK, where you are entitled to maternity leave. And that's true of Canada as well, though I'm not quite sure about the circumstances for postdocs. But I mean, in the US, it could be quite it's a bit upsetting, I think. You know, I remember being at the University of Missouri and there was a postdoc there that was just about to give birth and go on leave. But then I found out that apparently there was only 2 weeks of paid maternity leave that was provided to her. And I think that's just like outrageous, right? Because if I think about myself, like after I gave birth, I think there was a solid like 3 weeks where you know, things were really rough. And there's no way I could have been expected to return to work. You know, I was just not there mentally or physically, right? So to only have 2 weeks of paid leave and being expected to come back to life, I mean, those are really important. I mean, I think that's ridiculous. And I think that, you know, that may, if you can help that, be an important factor in where you choose to have children, right? And in terms of uprooting your family to go to a new job, I mean, I personally make my decisions based on what will benefit the whole family. And I know that some of the choices that I've made will mean that it just takes me a lot longer to realize my career goals. So, I mean, I like to just think of myself as taking the scenic route through the academic pathway towards hopefully, potentially a permanent position sometime in the future. But I mean, that's just my personal belief. And I believe that. But also, you know, I feel that I'm quite privileged in being able to do that because I have a partner that has a stable job that can support me financially in doing so. So I'm able to make that choice. But I think that will be something that will be determined by you and your personal circumstances and what you can do. So, yeah. The next question was, how do you divide up parenting with your partner if you have one? So I do have a partner, I have a husband. And the thing that my husband and I try to do is we try to remember that we're a team and that we have the same goals, which is ideally just to, you know, both of us have a career that we're both trying to maintain. We're both academics and we also have this small child that we want to be, you know, great parents for. So, I mean, so we try our hardest to work as a team to do this. And one of the ways that we do it is to try to split the care that we give to our child as evenly as possible. So, I mean, we try to do everything for our child and we try to avoid, you know, these gender specific expectations. Like, for example, you know, I'm the one who provides the most amount of like care on certain days or whatever. We really do try to split it equally. And I think we've done a pretty good job of that. I mean, I think our son looks to us both equally as a parent that he could depend upon for, you know, for food, for being changed, for like entertainment, you know. And I know that's not possible in all cases, but I mean, that was important to us. And that's what we sort of strive for. And so when we do have times when we have to provide, you know, care, like especially on the weekends, like sometimes what we'll do is we'll shift off to allow each other off. So we'll have like morning shifts. So the person who gets up in the morning, you know, has an hour and a half shift. And then while the other person like sleeps in, and then we'll switch off, you know, and that allows us each time, you know, in some cases, if we need to catch up on work, we can do that, or life tasks, or even just sleep, you know. So I mean, that's really helpful for us. So that's what we try to do. And I think a key aspect to just generally making it work is to be organized, right? I mean, I'm at a stage right now where I'm not too busy, but my husband is far more so than me. But what helps is for us to plan ahead of time, to make lists, just to make sure that we're aware of what we need to do. I mean, I think that making lists is a huge thing for me, because I would say, referring to the earlier slide about baby brain and all that, my brain is definitely not what it once was in terms of memory. So making lists really does help me. I think having shared diaries is something that I've heard that people do that is really useful. And, you know, I think my husband shares a diary with me, so I get pings about what he has to do, but I'm not so busy yet that the opposite is true. But I imagine in the future, you know, that would be really helpful. But I think what's key for us right now is that we give each other enough notice. So we let each other know, for example, if we have, you know, something that we need to do. So for example, you know, I have to give this talk this afternoon. So my husband's aware that he has to be the one that's going to go in and pick up our son from nursery. And, you know, it's okay. And as long as we have notice, I think it's been pretty easy for us to be able to plan around, you know, each other's schedules. Right, so what support have you received from funders and from your employer with paternal leave and returning to work? Was there support you wish you'd liked and you didn't get? So overall, I would say that my experience has been very positive. And I think a lot of it has to do with the systems in place at the university I work at and in the UK in general, which is really great. The Alzheimer's Society has been very, very understanding. And so what I did was I was able to put my fellowship in abeyance for the period of time. And then I was supported financially by the school for the times I took off. And it's wonderful because you have the ability to actually take an entire year off. Though, I mean, your pay does decrease over time. And I think if you get towards the latter stage of the year of maternity leave, you're not being paid by the school anymore. So, I mean, if you plan, properly financially, it you do have the ability to take the entire year off. I chose not to take the entire year off, mostly because of a personal thing. I just felt like I had had enough of an experience being off with my child all day. I even though I found, you know, parenting to be great, I missed the added element of being able to work and the intellectual stimulation that comes from that. So I chose to go back earlier because of that. But you know, you may choose not to, and that's great. I mean, if you want to take the whole year, you should take the entire year off. And also the school had a number of keeping in touch days that were available for me to take. And these were a number of days that were paid for by the school for me to come in and have meetings with my supervisors just to touch base and make sure that, you know, even though I was away, that I was still thinking about, you know, things I needed to do and objectives that I had. And in my case, there were days where I had to go in to make sure that my fly socks didn't die while I was away. So I did that, and that was really nice that you had the opportunity to do this, and it was also being paid for by the school. But I think what is really, really important, and I would say, you know, I mean, it's important on so many levels, I mean, for your career, is just to find really good supervisors that are really good mentors. I personally found myself like really, really fortunate because I had two supervisors. So I have Professor David Shepherd and Professor Emmerich Mother, who's at the University of Southampton. And both of them are so understanding of my choice to like have a child and to take that time off. In fact, you know, Emmerich, you know, who has small children herself, was always like, you know, you need to get on that. You need to do that right away, as opposed to, you know, sometimes you hear these horror stories, especially in North America, where people tell you, you know, having a child is going to ruin your career. Don't do it, you know, and people actually say stuff like that. So it was a huge breath of fresh air for me to be in a circumstance where, you know, I had these mentors that are encouraging me to do these things. And validating, you know, these choices I was making, that, you know, having a personal life and doing these personal things for yourself is just as important as, you know, having an academic career. And David himself has kids, and his circumstance was, at the time, his own daughter was pregnant, about to have a child too. So he really understood, you know, the issues that I was facing, and, you know, and they're both very, very understanding of, you know, times in which I would have to, times in which I couldn't work at full capacity because I didn't feel well, for example, during my pregnancy, or, you know, times where it took, well, I have to take days off. You know, it's still ongoing with the pandemic, which I'll touch upon a little bit later, but like, there's times where I have to take time off to go take care of my son because he's not well, or, you know, I've been told by the nursery I have to come pick him up. So they've been very understanding about that. But I think what's key is also being honest with your team about what you can and cannot do. And so they're not expecting you to do things that, you know, you can't. And I think that comes back to being realistic and managing your expectations. And I mean, that's hard to do, but that's something that I'm learning as I go along. So what was parenting working from home like for you during the pandemic? So I would say that working from home is wonderful and great, and it should be encouraged. And it's wonderful, great if you have access to childcare. So early on in the pandemic, when we're in full lockdown, I mean, those were very, very, very hard times. Because I found myself, I mean, my husband and I found ourselves at home trying to work and also parent a 14-month-old child that is high energy and not the type of child that you can easily just like entertain by putting down or putting in front of the TV. Like my son is like full on, like you have to be there. You have to be like playing with him. You need to just be there. And it was so exhausting, right? So we tried shifting off, where we do, you know, about like 2.5-hour shifts to get through the day. And so, and to give ourselves enough time that we can actually get into our work and like get into the zone. And we tried doing that, but, you know, I found that that was really, really hard. And a lot of the times I found that, you know, I was using my shifts to just catch up on sleep. And so at some point in time, we decided that I would be furloughed. And the reason that I chose to be furloughed, not my husband, is that I am still in a very, very early stage of my career where I don't have a lot of people that are dependent upon me, whereas my husband has, you know, he has like a bunch of students. He has a bunch of undergrad students and master's students, and he has PhD students. And so it's very difficult for him to have taken that time off. So I decided that I would be furloughed, and I just spend that time just providing all the childcare to my son without having to worry about work, because that was a huge, huge, huge stress, having to worry about doing both things at once. So that was very, very tough. But things have improved dramatically, but it is still an ongoing struggle, because in the sense that, like, you know, there are days where we'll be called in and my son will have, you know, a cough, right? They have this rule now. It's like you cough and you're out. And then you have to go to nursery, pick up your child, and then you have to take them to go get a COVID test. And getting, like, you know, performing COVID test, like, you know, doing the swab on like my son is one of the most awful experiences, because he screams at the top of his lungs, and it, you just feel awful restraining this little human to try to, you know, get a sample. So I've had to do that at least 3 or 4 times now. And then, so you have to wait for these positive tests. You have to wait for the test results to come back, and then you could take them back to nursery. And so, you know, there's days where we've had to just take the day off from work, and, you know, you might have a deadline, but then here you go, you know, you have to deal with this added element. So, I mean, it's still ongoing and it's still really difficult. But what I've been learning to do is just accept that I can only do the best that I can, and to try to be as flexible as possible. And my husband and I both try to be flexible with each other in terms of, you know, like, who has an imminent deadline. Okay, so if you have a grant due the next week, then, you know, you get a little bit of leeway, and the person who doesn't have pressing demands takes on the majority of the childcare and that sort of thing. So that's sort of how we've been managing it currently. And it has been hard. It's been even difficult, more difficult for us because my husband and I are both Canadian. So a lot of our family members are, you know, overseas back in Canada. So we don't really have that sort of support, right? So we're heavily reliant upon the nursery for taking care of our child. So it's tough, but we are managing. And I personally wouldn't change it. Like, I really enjoy still working during this period, right? Okay, so then the next question I had is, what challenges have you faced as an academic? I feel like this, have I not dealt with this before? Okay, anyways, everyone, what challenges have we faced as academic? Okay, so I think a lot of it has to do with the dichotomy between trying to be a good employee and also being a devoted parent. And I think this really depends on you and, you know, your own personal experiences as well, right? I mean, I find a challenge is that, you know, you return to work and women and men, but more so women, are expected to work like they don't have children, right? And for women coming back from maternity leave, you're almost expected to hit the ground running. And that's really hard to do, right? Because you're still really recovering from the entire process of having had a child and, you know, and learning how to manage all these things in your life, right? And it's hard and it may seem a bit unfair sometimes that you can't always make these milestones, for example, right? So for example, during the early stages of the pandemic in the department that I work in, there were record numbers of grants that are being submitted by people. And I could only imagine that these are being submitted by people that either don't have small children or don't have children. Because it was really, really, really difficult for my husband and I to do anything, really, right? There were no grants that were submitted. There were no papers, I think, that were submitted during that period of time because we were both so exhausted. And so, you know, you have the tendency to, like, feel bad about this. And I don't think we should. And I feel that there should be systems in place to recognize, you know, how hard it is for people that do have children. And I think people do try. And I have noticed that when I've been applying for fellowships recently, that some fellowships do give you a space to provide information about how, you know, how the pandemic has affected you. So you could talk about, you know, why your productivity has been limited. And same thing with, like, you know, progress reports from your department as well. I mean, there's spaces for you to explain this, but generally speaking, I mean, it is hard because it does seem a bit like unfair. And there are definitely times during the pandemic where I genuinely thought that I think I would have to quit academia, to be honest, because it just seemed so overwhelming and I just did not see how I would overcome a lot of these issues. But at the same time, I feel like there was some support that was provided that helped. I mean, for example, like furlough really helped me. And then the Welsh government offered up some scholarship award money to help, you know, bridge people and extend people's contracts during this period of time. So all of that has really helped. But I think overall, if you find yourself in a position where you feel the system isn't working for you, I think it's really important to speak up and to join committees or to serve on committees such as Athena Swan and voice your opinions about this, or at least contact your superiors and let them know that things need to change. Because I think that things have come a long way, but I think there still is a lot of room for improvement. I think the other thing is that, you know, parents in general and mothers are expected to care for their children like they don't have a job. So sometimes I do feel that people think people are judging you potentially for keeping a job and also having a child. And I mean, I personally don't feel so much judgment from the people that I'm friends with and I'm close to. But I do think that this is something that a lot of new mothers have dealt with from what I've picked up from talking to friends of mine. And I think at the end of the day, I think you just have to do what makes you happy and your family happy. And in my personal circumstance, I feel that working and being a parent is is great for everyone. It keeps me sane. And when I'm sane and happy, everybody else around me is happier. So I think, you know, you do what's best for you. But I do think it's important to have around you a good support network of friends and family and mentors and positive role models. So, you know, I have friends that are in a similar situation as me that, you know, also have young children and are trying to work. And it's really helpful to have talks with them. And it's really nice to talk to, you know, my mentor, so Emrit, who's great because she has children and she'll offer her advice or like tell me, you know, don't worry about it, you know, do the best you can. And that's really nice to have. And so I think that's really important to have around you a support network that can help you and support you and keep you going, especially in times where you find yourself struggling a bit. So what challenges have you faced as academic and parent? Okay, I mean, continuing on that, I mean, there's been difficulty making major milestones. So for example, delayed publication, which I imagine will have an impact on my career, but hopefully not too big of one. I've had to learn how to be more flexible. Learn to be more spontaneous and also trying to use the flexibility of academia to my benefit, right? So I know that if something pops up during the day, takes me away from work, I know that I could do it later. Like even if I have to sacrifice the evening or an hour on the weekend, I could do it. But I think it's also important that, you know, on days in which you feel really, really terrible, that you take a time for your mental health. Like if I'm having a day where I can't do anything because I'm just so overwhelmed, I will just take like, you know, an hour or two to myself and just go grab a coffee or go for a walk or meet a friend, you know, and, you know, work can wait till a little bit later. And that's okay, because in academia, there's all this flexibility involved that you don't have to do things at a particular time in a 9-to-5 schedule. You could do it a bit later. But I tend to prioritize my mental health in situations like that. I think there is a major struggle with finding autonomy. Once you've had a child and you're part of this family now, you know, and it's hard to take time for yourself and to do things that you really like. But I think that's so important. And I think it's so important not to guilt yourself for taking the time to do that. And I'm still learning how to do this. And I'm still learning how to ask for more time. And my partner has been very, very supportive in you know, giving me the time that I ask for so that I can go off and do something with myself, whether it's like, you know, a hobby or whether it's just, you know, have a night out with a friend to have dinner. You know, all these little things really do help you. And I don't think you should feel guilty about it. Another big thing is being present. I think sometimes in the past, especially, I would come home and I'd bring all my stresses and worries about the job home with me. And that's something that you really can't do if you want to be there for your child. And I've been really working really hard to try to be present in the moment. And it helps just turn off your computer and email alerts and put your computer away and just, you know, practice some level of mindfulness. Like I find that breathing kind of helps me to bring myself back to the present. So I'm not worried about work. And when I'm with my child, I'm there playing with my child. And, you know, that's still really hard for me, but it's something that I think it has been working and it does make me feel a lot better when I can do it. So that's been really important for me. What has been the best aspect of being an academic and a parent? I mean, I think the big thing is that it's really put my work and my life in perspective. You know, the things that seem like they're so big and just so monumental just don't seem as significant anymore when you think about the fact, like, okay, you know, at the end of the day, all that really matters is your child, you know, and they come first and their needs. And so it really does help me put all these things in perspective. Like, you know, if I don't, you know, get something done, if I don't get an award, I'm like, ah, you know what, like, at least I have the health of my child. And that's really, really something to be, you know, happy about, I think. So it's really helped me put things in perspective. I find that I am less worried about perfection and I will just do the best that I can. And, you know, I won't obsess over something having to be absolutely perfect before I submit it. I mean, I just do the best with the time that I have and then submit it, you know, and I've been finding that generally speaking has worked in my favor. And I think that overall, I do feel a greater sense of self and happiness and fulfillment since becoming a parent, and also having both aspects in my life, both being able to do work that I am interested in and proud of and driven by, and a purpose in that sense, in an academic sense, but also, you know, being able to be a mother, which is something I've personally always wanted to do as well, right? So I think it does feel like a greater sense of wholeness, even though it is very difficult at times. And I do think that becoming a parent has overall just made me a better person. I do think that I have a lot less anxiety than I used to have, and a lot of that has to do with me just putting things in perspective and being less worried about perfection. But also, I think it helps you to become more empathetic. I mean, you could understand that other people have struggles in their lives too, right? So it makes it a little bit easier when dealing with other people. I really think in my personal circumstance, the whole pregnancy-induced brain wiring really helped in my case. So I do suffer from some of the effects of baby brain still. But overall, I think it's helped me. It's made me a less anxious person and a more caring person, I would say. What challenges and joys do you see ahead of you as a parent in academia? So, I mean, I can't wait personally to introduce my son to science. I can't wait to take him into the lab with me and show him my flies and that sort of thing, because he really does get interested and excited about like animals and new things. So I just can't wait to see his expression when you take him in and show him some stuff. So that's something I look forward to. I do ultimately on the other side foresee, you know, as things progress and as I move up my career, that I will find myself during periods of time not having the time to make every important event in my son's life. And I feel that it's something that I don't want to miss. But I will have to deal with the guilt of having to miss them. But the ways in which I can mitigate this is something that I'm starting to do even now, is to try to protect my time, especially as a parent. And some of this involves just saying no to people and not feeling obliged to have to please everyone and say, yes, I'll give that talk. Yes, I'll be here. I'll do that. In fact, I'll do that. You know, like I'm getting to a point where I could just say, you know, I just don't have the time. I'm sorry. I could do this, but I can't do that. And just being honest with people. And I found that people tend to just be like, yeah, okay, you know, we'll just find somebody else that's available. And thank you, you know, and hopefully at another time you will be available to help, right? Another thing is trying to be realistic about expectations. So again, like, you know, just knowing that, yeah, I may not be able to make every event, but I'll make some, and that's important. And that's better than nothing. And also just remembering to use the flexibility of academia to my benefit. So if I have to take time off to do something here, that I can make it up at another time. And usually that's fine. And other than that, these are just some interesting links to some articles that I had found, and that paper that I found, if you're interested in reading it, was published in Nature Neuroscience. But other than that, I think that's it. Hopefully there was something in there that was useful or helpful to you, or made you think about something that you wouldn't have otherwise thought about.
Thank you so much, Lovesha, for sharing. What an amazing candid talk. I've never seen anyone before present so comprehensively, uncovering so many issues. I feel this is going to be helpful to so many other people, just to realize that they're not the only ones that are feeling the way you do and experiencing the challenges of managing a career and family at the same time. So if you'd like to find out more information about Lovesha, her work, and get access to her tips and read her biography, you can do that on our website at dementiaresearcher.nihr.ac.uk. And of course, thank you to the Alzheimer Society that fund the work there at Bangor and so many other studies across the country. You can find out information on them at alzheimers.org.uk. Our next session will be on the 29th of October, so please do remember to join us then, where we'll hear from Dr. Soyon Hong from the UK Dementia Research Institute and Dr. Julia Ravey, They're going to be talking about microglia and synapses loss in neurological disease. And then our second career session will be on using social media for communicating your research. Thank you very much again, and we'll look forward to seeing you soon.